A great light from the sky suddenly shone around me. This word suddenly, as I recently spoke in a, or wrote in an online homily on our website, if you want, the last one, it's about the suddenness of grace. This word suddenly in the scriptures, its various forms, suddenly, straight away, immediately, instantaneously, indicates a direct intervention of the power of God. We find this term 40 times in the Gospel according to St. Mark. It's very important in St. Mark's Gospel. Everything is happening suddenly. And we know from the scriptures we hear, suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, or suddenly there came forth from his side blood and water, or suddenly there was a sound as of a great wind and they were filled with the Holy Spirit. And now here, suddenly a great light shone around him. God's grace, even though it may seem to us to function slowly and unevenly over a long period of time, actually always operates in the present instant. Because, of course, it is a supernatural gift, wholly divine, which is given to us. Practically speaking, the only kind of grace there really is for us here below is a grace of conversion. And we celebrate today the conversion of St. Paul, the only feast of conversion of a saint that is celebrated universally in the church, unless you account the Immaculate Conception and as a kind of super conversion, because of course it was in her person that the whole human race returned to God. But in St. Paul's case, and that was an instantaneous too, from the first instant of her conception, you get the, you know, the theme is always there. Basically, we have in our life our fallen nature and the promise of redemption and the work of grace in us from our baptism through faith throughout the course of our life. But our conversion is continuous and yet always instantaneous. Why continuous? Because we're always dealing with the same persons, places, and things, whether we're dealing with them sinfully or whether we're dealing with them in a way which is pleasing to God, whether they become the occasions or the causes of our turning away from him, our aversion to God, or whether they become the occasions and causes of our turning towards him. But it's the same world. The Protestants have a nice hymn, "This is my Father's world." So it's the same world. St. Paul was going to be dealing with his same body, his same soul, his same Christians, his same vocation to follow the revelation of the God of Israel. All of these things were going to remain the same. But what would change would be that he would be directing his life towards the service of God and not away from him to the service of the evil one. Our conversion, as our theology teaches us, is always an instantaneous thing. The infusion of grace, the forgiveness of sins, we're constantly being called back. This is for us a motive of great hope, because what it means is that whatever's happened up to the present moment, even if the last moment was a grave sin, the present moment can be an instantaneous salvific turning to God. Now, hopefully our life is not full of moments where we're constantly committing grave sins, but let's just say, as St. Francis de Sales teaches in his introduction, he will be celebrated yesterday, that even should we have committed the worst sin imaginable or some grave sin, we should not hesitate for a moment. We should immediately, again, there's immediately, cling to the mercy of the Savior and ask for his pardon. We shouldn't waste any time waiting to feel contrite or to get up the gumption to consider what it is we're going to do, but we should return to him all at once and immediately, always there with his grace, both sanctifying or habitual, we say, and actual. Actually, that's just a parenthesis. It's habitual grace and actual grace, because actual graces are sanctifying. So, you know, sometimes we say sanctifying grace, actual grace, but all graces are sanctifying. One of them is our new life in Christ. The other is the help we get to do certain actions, but it's all sanctifying, right? St. Thomas is pretty clear about that. So with St. Paul, He receives this grace of conversion. And in what does it consist? And it's so beautiful because it has nothing to do with anything except Jesus Christ. That's it. Nothing else. Our Lord says, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" This is the authoritative word on the nature of his aversion and his life of deep sin and enmity with God, persecuting Christ's members. But Christ tells him in that instant that whatsoever you do to the least of my brethren, you've done it to me. He establishes his identity with the persons with whom St. Paul has been dealing, and with all of them. So that when he says, "Why are you persecuting me?" he's talking about other people that St. Paul is persecuting by attacking them for their fidelity to Christ. So our Lord, when we convert, shows us his identification with his gifts, the gifts of other people around us, the gifts of the means of serving him, our goods of soul and body, the fulfillment of our natural needs. Our Lord reveals to us that all of that really is just entirely meant to be a means of union with him, and that our conversion consists precisely in being aware and acting always in Christ, so that those with whom we deal represent him, and not just represent him, but are identified by him with himself. Would that Catholics were zealous to defend this particular identification, as sometimes they are to defend the real presence in the Eucharist. I don't know. I mean, he said, "Whatsoever you do to the least of my brethren, you did it to me." He didn't say, "To me symbolically, to me after a manner of speaking." No, it's not really me. It's somebody else, but I'm just saying it in order to get you to be nice. No, our Lord takes it personally because he is the firstborn of all creation, the head of our race, the new Adam, our spiritual father, and the one who will raise us from the dead on the last day. And the nature of our union with him, what it really consists of, is a mystery beyond our comprehension, like the mystery of faith we celebrate here on the altar. And so it is with all the other things that serve our human life, and that means absolutely everything with which we come into contact. So if we would convert, let us just turn our eyes, blinded by the light of the truth, to Jesus and ask him to guide us and to help us to see him in everyone we meet, in all those whom we serve, in our friends and in our foes, and also to see him in all of the good gifts he gives us in order to serve him, gifts of body and of soul, which are of course meant to serve our neighbor who is, as our Lord says, identified with him. St. Paul's conversion is the standard St. Augustine uses to explain just what the nature of the church is, the union, the identification of Christ's members with himself. And here is the proof text. Saul persecuted the church, and Christ says, "Why do you persecute me?" This is one Christ in head and members, and here is the place and the moment of our conversion. Let us take it to ourselves and serve him this day, and we'll receive abundant graces and become, as St. Paul, freed from our sins, calling upon the name of Jesus, and can become as well vessels of election to bring his name to the nations.